That's one odd little tree. You know, I spent, I think it was like 2-3 years pruning this thing. And I had this plan. I had a big plan. Yes, I did. I had plans of making it come down and have lower branches and stuff. And it's doing that. Yes, it's doing it beautifully. But every time I prune this, and this happens to a lot of people, when you prune your tree during the growing season, it puts out these water sprouts or new branches going straight up from the middle of the tree. And you wonder, what the heck's going on in here? Well, that's just your tree's way of putting out new growth. And I hope the wind isn't messing up my microphone. If it is, I'm just going to have to reshoot this. But anyway, somebody posted on my Facebook a picture of their apple tree. And they were pruning it just like mine. And what happened is it put out all these little sprouts. And what they did was, I thought this was fascinating because it was something that I never even thought of, is that they cut out 2/3 of these branches going up. So they only left 1/3 of them. So they didn't leave all of these up there, because you can't leave them all up there, because they'll put out little apples all over the place on top and you won't get as many down here. At least that's what I've seen. But they took out 2/3 of them, left 1/3 of them going up, so that they will put up some apples up there. And also the leaves up there will help shade the apples down here, so the birds don't see them as much, because that's the problem that I've had, is I actually do have apples. Unfortunately, these are not my apples. But what happened was, is we had a late frost, and it killed most of the blossoms. And so I didn't have hardly any apples. I did have a half a dozen apples, and that really made me happy. Well, what happened was, is some of them got pecked, and some of them got nibbled, and right towards the end, there was two beautiful apples, Honeycrisp apples. This is a Honeycrisp apple tree. And Honeycrisp, for those of you who have tasted them, are just incredibly delicious, sweet, the most perfect apple you'll ever want to bite into. Well, there was two apples on the lower part of the tree, and they were shaded and everything, and Mike, the dishwasher, and I would come out and take the dogs for a walk every day, and we'd look at our apple and just think of the day in November, and that's when we pick them, in November, when it gets cool out here and it gets close to frost. We were waiting for the day that we could pick them. And then we came out one day and there were no apples on the tree. It turns out the deer who marched through here, they looked up into the tree and thought, ooh, apples, the same as we did, and they ate our apples. So we got zero apples this year. So I'm walking around with this bucket of apples. And what we did was, it smells so good. I love the smell of apples. The flavor is good, of course. I like apples. But the smell reminds me of when I was a teenager. I think I was 13 years old, living with my dad. And I put that in my book, by the way. And it just always takes me back. It's a happy smell, even though not all my times with my dad were happy. It brings me happiness. Well, anyway, Mike and I were at the grocery store buying stuff for Thanksgiving. And he picked up a bag of apples because he really loves apples just as much as I do. Unfortunately, when you're at the grocery store, you know what happens when you buy tomatoes. They don't taste like tomatoes. I even have a couple tomatoes in my house. I diced them up and I put them on a salad, and it was like eating cucumbers. The crunch was like cucumbers, and I thought, well, this ain't right. But anyway, the apples, they're either grainy or they have no flavor. And I've never, until the last 10 years, I never have had an apple that didn't have any flavor at all. And so I don't know what they're doing with the apple trees nowadays, but it's just not right. Anyway, so we have all these apples in our fridge, and I bring them out every day, and I take them to the chickens, and I stomp them, break them into pieces, and feed them to the chickens, because luckily the chickens are not too picky about their apples. So nothing goes to waste around here. I'm gonna feed them flavorless apples. They're gonna give me poop, and that poop is gonna make compost, and compost is gonna make the whole world happy. That's how I have it planned out. But anyway, I wanted to mention that about my apple tree. I didn't prune it. I wait until the leaves are all off of it. And we have not had really, really cold weather. It's actually going to be in the upper 60s here. And this is the day after Thanksgiving, Black Friday. And this is when everybody's out shopping. So God only knows if anybody's watching my programs. They're probably out getting cheap TVs at Walmart. But anyway, for those few of you who are watching my programs, yeah, I'm going to wait till the leaves are off. Then I want to prune this thing down. But I have some leaves to gather, not apple leaves, but other leaves. And it's for the goats. So if you want to take a walk, go for a walk. Oh. There's one. There's another one. Hey, rascal. Sniff the leaves. You gotta stop and sniff the leaves. Oh, and they do smell good. Hey, Tanner Butt. How you doing, you little tripod? You know, I've only had these little crazies, these two here, Tiki and Tanner, for, I don't know, only a handful of months. And it seems like they've been here forever. They just, their experience here has been something else. It's quite a journey. They're just completely at home. Something about them. This is unfortunate. I have to walk by this stupidity. What am I walking on over here? Oh, I have to walk by this stupidity every single day, and I've pointed this out. But as some of you who follow along faithfully have noticed, it's gotten bigger. You see, this is my property over here, and as I swing the camera around, you can see this is the western fence line. This is the edge of my property, and then here's farmland, or actually it's not even farmland, because the guy who rents this property next to me doesn't farm it anymore. This used to be corn and soybeans, and now it's just wild grasses and stuff. But what he's been doing is, he's been doing this since before I lived here. He has this old trailer. Yeah, it's just an old trailer on wheels, and it's on the right up against my fence. It's actually touching my fence. And he dumps garbage on it. I mean, there's a Chevrolet truck door, a bed door, and an old weed whacker that's rusted and not working anymore. You know, just basically general scrap junk nonsense. And there was a few things on here. And just on Thanksgiving, yesterday on Thanksgiving, this guy, instead of spending time with his family and just relaxing and being thankful for what he has, he came over here with his truck, pulling a trailer, and there was a skid steer, a little baby tractor on it, and he drove that thing off of there, and he unloaded all of this garbage that you see here onto and around the trailer. Yeah, and he even dug up the ground here as he did that. But yeah, this is what he did on Thanksgiving. This is the pig who lives next door to me. He doesn't even live on this property. He rents it from another person, from what I understand, and he farms a few acres. That's it, just about maybe 4 or 5 acres of it, and he uses it for a dumping ground. You know, it would be, you know, I've mentioned this before, and people actually jumped on my butt about it. They said, why don't you take care of it? Why don't you get rid of it? Why don't you have coffee and take him cookies and talk to him about it? No, I'm not going to do that, because, you know, it's just not my responsibility to train a pig. You know, a person who's going to do something like this is not going to take kindly to somebody telling him don't do it, because if he had any kind of class or brain at all, he wouldn't need anybody to tell him not to do this or ask him not to do this. And it's not my responsibility to clean up after everybody who pollutes the planet. It's my responsibility to take care of my land, to tend my garden. It's up to him to tend his own. And yeah, he's not taking care of his own. So what I'm going to do is, on this side of it, let me move over here. Yeah, I'm swinging this camera around like wild, but it's the best that I can do. Right over here, Mike and I, we did our little bit, and we're going to do a little bit more each year. Right here, these little sticks, these are the remains of the sunchokes. We planted a little sunchoke bulb over here, Jerusalem artichoke. And what we're going to do each year is we're going to plant right along this fence. And I'm also going to plant some vines to grow along the fence and try to cover up this nonsense. I can't cure the world, but I can cover it up with plants and at least give me the illusion that a pig doesn't live next door to me. Well, enough griping. I go on my little rants every now and then, because even though I try to stay positive and stay happy, every now and then something comes along and it tests my limits and I get a little fired up, but then I find my center and I just relax, because I think, you know what, you can't change the world, so don't even stress out over it. Just change the things you can. And I've accepted that I can't change him, but one of the nice things, and I find the one nice thing about it, I try to find the positive in just about everything I run into. He's an old guy. You know, you can't teach old dogs new tricks. But one thing you can do is you can outlive those old dogs. And eventually, he's not going to be around. So he'll stop dumping. I mean, once you're dead and gone, you stop dumping. So the land will probably go back to the owner who rents it to him. And that owner isn't going to be dumping out here. So I won't have to look at it forever. Hopefully, he'll clean it up. That would be kind of nice. What we're doing today... Hey, Tiki! How you doing? Hello, sweetie. I'm picking oak leaves up off the ground. This is what I do. I go out and I don't bring the goats out or the chickens out. They stay in their fenced area. But right above your head is are a couple old oak trees. And I love oak trees. I miss those from Minnesota. And I'm out here picking through the other leaves because there's other trees out here. I'm picking up oak leaves out of here because Lewis. Lewis, I'm going to be this old man who can't remember his pets' names, but Bucky and Lewis, they love oak leaves, and they can't come out here and eat them themselves. And that's one thing that goats do. They eat leaves. They love leaves. People confuse goats with sheep. Sheep are grazers. Goats are pickers. So goats will walk around and eat bark and eat little saplings and eat tree leaves and stuff. They will eat some grasses, but they prefer dry grasses and stuff. But one of their favorite things are oak leaves. And goats are really fascinating little creatures. Hi, Tanner. Hi there. They have a gut that is very specific. And they have this bacteria in their gut that digests the cellulose that's in leaves and wood. It's kind of, you know, like a beaver. A beaver eats wood, and you wonder, how can you get any nutrition off of that? They have specific bacteria that basically ferments and helps them digest that, and they need it. That's the thing. They actually need that. They can't survive off of just hay and on green grasses and stuff. So until the snow comes, and hopefully it's not in the near future, I come out here with my little bucket every day, rain or shine, and I collect one bucket of leaves for the goats, and then I go in there and I spend some time with them because that's what I do. And I give them oak leaves, and they eat them out of my hand. And it really makes me happy, and it makes them very happy, and so it's a good thing for both of us. They don't really like other kinds of leaves, and that's really kind of strange. You think, they'll eat any leaves. No, they won't. That is the weird thing. I've tried feeding them these other thinner leaves that you see all over the place, but they don't like them. And so I don't try and force it on them. It's kind of like me and beets, you know? They will eat them. If there's nothing else to eat and they're really hungry, they will eat those leaves. And I was thinking about that this morning. I thought, you know what? It's kind of like me and beets. I don't like beets. Never did like beets. I wrote about that in my book. Those of you who read the book, you know why I don't like beets, okay? Nobody's going to change my mind about liking beets. I won't eat them. Now, there is a disclaimer. If I were out in the wild and I was fighting for my life, somebody dumped me out of a plane and I rolled down a mountain and I'm fighting for my life and I'm clawing my way up a rocky steep cliff and I'm starving to death and it's snowing and I'm going to die, and then a beet rolls down the mountain and hits me on the head, I will eat that beet. But other than that, you're not getting me to eat a beet. I don't like the taste of them. Some people don't like certain foods, and you shouldn't try to force them to eat them. And my mom tried to trick me once, and that gave me this lifelong obsession about never having a beet go near my mouth again. So no, I don't do that, and I don't force my goats to eat anything that they don't want to. Okay, I think I got enough leaves over here, and the dogs are done rolling in whatever they're rolling in over there. Let's go that way, okay? Every day, as soon as I gather up the leaves, it's kind of like a routine we have here at the farm. Every day I come out, I gather leaves, I put them in a bucket, and Mike helps too. Mike likes coming out here and helping with that too. Even though he's not a gardener, he does like the farm life and stuff. And if my camera were better, you could see these little bitty birds flitting around in here, okay? Every day I walk the perimeter of the fence before I go inside, and I check, and I know this is kind of sad, but this is what you have to do out here. I check for dead birds, because the hawks, they don't leave the area. They are always hunting. They are always on the hunt. And two nights ago, I saw an owl. Yeah, we actually have an owl out here. But the hawks are the main concern, because during the night, the chickens go inside. Well, the hawk has gotten two of my birds so far. Remember Iowa? Iowa was that chicken that I brought from Minnesota to Iowa. She was the sole bird that came out here. She was the grand dame of chickens. She was the boss. She kept all the other chickens in line. So she was about 4 years old. And sadly, it was 2 weeks ago that she came up missing. And I looked for her and I looked for her and I couldn't find her. And I thought, wow, what, did she go up in the rapture? And I couldn't find her. Well, I looked really carefully in here and I found one of her wings. And a hawk had come in here and just totally took her and left her wing. But I know it was a hawk because we've had a hawk around here recently swooping down on the chickens, and the chickens have been hiding around in these tall weeds. That's why I leave these weeds tall, because it helps the chickens fend for themselves, because there's nothing I can do. I mean, I can't cover this huge area with anything. So I leave these weeds tall so the chickens stay in there. The ones that come out here, they need to keep an eye out for things. But yeah, Iowa is no more, and that's really kind of sad. But she was an old bird, and she led a very, very happy life. But the nice thing about it is next spring, I'm going to hatch out some baby chicks. Hopefully one of the chickens will set on them and raise them themselves. But if not, I have an incubator in the house. And if I have to do it myself, and I really do enjoy hatching baby chicks. I don't know why, they just make me happy. Just like puppies and kitties and any other little baby animals, they just make me happy. You know, one of these days, and I know I can't have a dog that has babies. I don't advocate for that, you know. I advocate for spaying and neutering your animals. All my animals are always spayed and neutered. Well, one of these days, someday, I want to actually just lay down and be covered in puppies. I love puppies. There's something about puppies that just make me happier than anything else in this world. And one of these days, maybe I'll go visit somebody who has puppies and they'll let me lay down on their living room floor. This crazy old man came into my house and laid on my floor, but and get covered up in puppies, because they smell good. They're fun. Kitties are like that too. But anyway, I got to I'm just rambling right now. I do have to go feed the animals. But I did want to mention that, yeah, I will be hatching baby chicks and stuff. I got to feed these leaves to the goats and quit talking about it. Here, buddy. Ah, ah, you pig. You can't do that. Hey, Bucky. Come on over here. Look what I got. You like oak leaves, don't you? Yes, you do. And I have to feed them separately like this, because Lewis is a pig. Yes, he is. I've made my peace with that. He will horn in on Bucky's leaves, so I have to do this and feed them individually. Now, I also got to feed the chickens. Hey, you guys, peck that. The goats really don't much care for apples. See? Yeah. And even if I break them up into pieces, they won't eat them. But the chickens, I just stomp an apple, toss it, and game on. Hey, you. Come on, you get over here, you pig. Yeah, you are a pig. You know you are. This is good stuff. People tell me, Ray, I want to see more pictures of the animals. You know, there are sparrows flying all over the place in here, and a female cardinal. Yes, there's a female cardinal living in my chicken coop. They come into the chicken door and also like the crack over here. I don't have a totally 100% sealed up coop. And I do that for a reason. I want to make sure there's ventilation in here. Even in the winter, you need to have ventilation in your coop. So I leave that crack there, and the birds fly in and out through there, the little ones. Yeah, it's kind of cool. And so I have a mama cardinal, and I have a whole bunch of sparrows living in here. And they eat the same food and drink the same water that the chickens do. Yeah, I have a heated water bowl, and it just keeps the water at room temperature. It doesn't keep it actually hot. And I have a bowl of, baking soda that the goats can lick anytime they want. If you're going to raise goats, you have to have a bowl of baking soda, because every now and then in their gut, the enzymes and stuff get a little bit out of whack, kind of like we get an upset stomach every now and then, and it's like giving them Alka-Seltzer. You give them baking soda, and they will lick it as they need it. And remember, I think I might have mentioned one time a while back that the goats had, one of them had the bloat. It was either one actually both of them had the bloat at different times. And that's when their gut gets really huge and it's full of gas, and that can be deadly for goats. And I learned as I go with these animals. I knew nothing when I started, and I'm learning, you know. In time, I will be an expert at goats. I do know you keep your face away from their horns, and you make sure that they have plenty of room to run, because goats love to run, things to climb, and they will break and chew everything in sight. They do get along good with the chickens, and that's one of the nice things about it. You guys are happy, aren't you? Yes, you are. Bucky, he's laying outside. He's enjoying the last of this weather. He ate his leaves and he's out there. They just lay outside and soak up the sun. When winter gets here and it gets really cold and the snow's blowing, I block off the chicken door and everybody's stuck in here, and that's where they really start pooping up a storm inside of here and building up the manure that I'm going to need to make compost for next year. I have not forgotten about everybody's request for compost. I'm going to be making as much as I possibly can for next spring, because a lot of people missed out on this last compost offering, so I haven't forgotten about you. I'm going to need some more for my garden as well. I'm going to be busy. Yeah, now that we're out of leaves, he's going to start finding my microphone, so I better stand up. But he'll eat every part of my clothing. Anyway, I wanted to remind you one last thing. I think it was the episode before last, I mentioned that I did write a book, and I won't go on and on about that, but I want to give you an update on that, okay? I did write a book, and it is, I think it's a great creation of mine. I'm very proud of it, and people seem to like it a lot. Oh, no. We don't eat Ray's microphone. You just go away now. But I did write the book, and it's available on the website in the link below here. Open up the video description where it says Show More. Click that. There will be a link to the Lulu website. There's the book. But the twist is the ebook is now available, because some folks, they wanted the book, but they're out of the country, and shipping to other countries is astronomical. Well, if you don't mind reading it as an ebook format on your computer, on your phone, on your tablet, you can get the ebook format. It's the same exact thing, only you don't get the paperback book. The nice thing is I made it $2 less than the paperback book, and there's no shipping. Yes, there's no shipping. So you can save some money and you can get the same exact thing if you don't mind not having the actual paperback book. And also for people in the United States who would rather read an ebook, there it is for you. I wanted to make sure that I did that because people were asking, and I wanted to make sure that everybody was happy, as many people as possible. So I hope you will check out the website and check out the book. It does help me when people purchase this. It does help me raise some money to keep things going on the farm. And with the new addition to the creatures, I'm going to need more feed than ever before. But they seem to be liking their apples. Yeah, they do. And unfortunately, you know, Iowa won't be with us anymore, but we will have new life coming from the farm, and that's what it's all about, you know? It's a cycle of life. They come, they go, and we just, oh, why are you bleeding? Ah, I picked something off of his shoulder. I think he had a wart or a mole or something. I picked it off. I'm sorry. I won't pick any more parts of your body off, okay? I'm sorry, Lewis. I'm sorry. I got to get out of here before I kill my goat. Anyway, everybody, thank you for joining me on the farm today. I really do appreciate it. It was a good day. And like I mentioned in the Voodoo Garden episode, this holiday season, this Christmas season, be very careful out there and be good to each other. And I'll see you next week right here on the farm. Everybody abandoned me. I'm all alone over here. Okay. Have a good day, everybody. You like that apple, don't you? Yes, you do.